chord. Okay, so 4.1 and 4.3, you're going to introduce special triangle. Let's review a little bit about our stuff from grade 10. So take a look. I'm looking for a relationship that connects theta, in other words, the angle in question, with the red line, which I'm going to just, you know, vaguely just call it the height of my imaginary triangle. Now, this is just the floor. Don't think about it as the base of the triangle. In this particular case, if I were to refer to the triangle, I'm talking about this as my base, right? And this as my base, and this as my base, and this little thing as my base. Okay. Relationship between theta and the height of this triangle, so the dotted line. As the angle in question begins to increase, what would you say happens to the height of this triangle? And remember, the hypotenuse of each of these triangles is exactly the same. What do you notice about the relationship between the angle and the height? Anyone?
The height increases as well.
The height increases, absolutely. So, long, long, long time ago, people observed this relation. They're like, huh, is there a relationship? And just from a curious question like that, just they started digging deeper and finding more and more connections. And so, lo and behold, something funky happens, and then your teacher told you to memorize Soka Toa. That's literally what you know so far, right? As far as you know and as far as you care, I guess. There's actually some crazy stuff that goes on in between, you know, the circle-y arrow, which I don't have a time to get into per se, but I'm just going to say that, hey, there is a relationship between angle and theta. So I can start from, let's say, 15 degrees, and the height was, let's say, like 0.26, because, you know, that's a 1, so this has to be clearly less than 1. And I could do 30 degrees, that's going to be like 0.5. I could do 45 degrees, the height turns into like 0.71. I could do 60 degrees, 75 degrees, and then I get to 90 degrees, and it gets to a value of 1, which makes sense because if my hypotenuse is 1, so the length of this arm is 1, and it's a 90 degrees, what would you say the height of this triangle is? Well, I'm hoping you say it's also 1. But here's the funny part. Right now, this is 90 degrees. What if I went past 90 degrees? And this hypotenuse, or this length, is still 1. What do you think, what can you say about that dotted line? Is this dotted line bigger than 1? Because clearly the numbers are increasing, 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 increasing. Is this dotted line bigger than 1, or is it smaller than 1?
Smaller.
It is smaller. So if I were to turn this into a kind of a graph, in the beginning, my height, my theta, it increases really, really big, and then it starts to slow down until I hit a height of 1, and then as I, and remember this is like 90 degrees, and as I go past 90 degrees, it looks like the height begins to get smaller and smaller. So the height starts to slow down, and then it goes vroom. And it starts getting bigger, and that's, I'm going to say 180 degrees, because if the angle is 180 degrees, half of a circle, then my height, of course, becomes 0. So I just want to say this because in this unit, grade 11, okay, the extra extension, the upper level above what you might have learned in grade 10, is that we're taking the idea of triangles, and we're going to apply it. The idea of angles, right? We're going to apply it starting from the x-axis and see what happens if we explore an angle larger than 90 degrees. Okay, this is where we're going, all right? So before we get there, we're going to have to know a little bit about triangles. You ready? Let's review. So, ka toa. Given a triangle, it's got to be a right angle triangle. Okay, something like that. Boom, boom. And let's say this is my angle. I have angle XY, let's call it XYZ. X, Y, and X, Y, and Z. Okay? What would be the two sides we use when I ask, when the teacher asks for sine theta, or when anyone asks for the ratio of sine theta? What do you remember? Someone else. Someone else that has
Y and Z.
Y and Z, yeah. So in turn, when you're given a triangle, it is Y and Z, okay? But before I get there, you are, if this is the angle you're talking about, you have to label the triangle as opposite side, adjacent side, and of course the hypotenuse, right? And from there we learn that sine of theta is always going to be taking the opposite side and divide by the hypotenuse. And so in this case, it would be y over z. If the question asked for cosine as your ratio, someone else? Going once, going twice. I hope you have it in your head. It's actually taking the adjacent over hypotenuse, and that would be x over z. So essentially what this is, sine is looking at the relationship of y. If you remember, this was what I was doing, right? A sine is a relationship that investigates theta and the height. Theta with the height, theta with the height. In other words, theta with the opposite side of the angle. Cosine, the counterpart of it, is not looking at the height. Take a look. I'm going to highlight this. As the angle increases, what can you tell me about the base of each triangle? Is it getting longer or is it getting shorter?
Shorter.
Yeah, absolutely. And so, you know, if sine is investigating the height of the triangle with respect to theta, the cosine, you know, like co is like related, like corresponding. Co is corresponding. So if sine of theta is opposite over hypotenuse, what is a corresponding ratio? What is cosine? Adjacent over hypotenuse. So that's why we have x of z. And of course, if we are connecting y with z and then x with z, there should be a ratio that connects x with y. And therefore, we have tangent. Tangent is the opposite side divided by the adjacent side, hence y over x. So step one, if you remember, you gotta be able to recognize what the adjacent side is and what the opposite side is relative to theta, and then put it accordingly based on our acronym SOHCAHTOA. Sine means opposite over hypotenuse. Cosine, adjacent over hypotenuse. Tangent, opposite over adjacent. Any questions? That was basically half a chapter of grade 10. Okay. So from here, I'm going to introduce some special triangles because you're going to be using it quite often. 30 degrees, 45 degrees, and 60 degrees, along with, of course, 0 degrees and 90 degrees. These are very, very common angles to the point where when I ask you for sine 30 or cosine 30 or tangent of 30, I am going to ask for fractions, not a decimal value. Okay? So for example, everyone bust out your calculators. If you have sine 30, if you type in sine 30, you should get the answer 0.5 in your calculator. I don't want that. I want you to write 1 over 2. Which brings me to the next one. Sine 45. Someone who's followed along and actually took out their calculator. Can you do sine 45 for me?
2 root 2 over 2.
Oh, well, nice. Yeah, you got the fraction. We're gonna get there. But let's say you didn't have the fraction option. What is the decimal for this? What would a regular calculator give you?
0.707.
Yeah, something, 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 something. It's a really long one. That's annoying. Same with sine 60. Someone else? 0.
8 8 or 8 6 6.
Something, something, something. It gets really, really long. But you're right. Abby was like, no, this is root 2 over 2, and that is correct. Are we supposed to be in a certain mode? Yes, we're still dealing with degrees. So your calculator should have either DEG or a capital D with a box around it or something showing you that it's in degree mode. Okay. If you're not sure how to change it, I will show you in class. Don't worry about it for now. I guess someone else can handle it. Okay, so how do we get to this fraction mode if we, even without a calculator? And this is where special triangles come in. 30, 45, 60, as I said, is so common. I want it in fractions. How do we know turn this into fraction? I'm going to take a triangle with simple sides and use nothing but Pythagorean theorem to get us proper fractions. Okay? So here comes the first one. I have with me an isosceles triangle. An isosceles means that two angles non-90 degrees has to be equal. So it has no choice but to be 45 degrees, 45 degrees. Next, I'm going to set my two equal sides to be the easiest number I know, 1 and 1. If that's the case, what is my hypotenuse? Well, hypotenuse is 1 squared plus 1 squared, which is 2. C, or the hypotenuse, is going to be root 2. Now you see it. If this is the case, what is sine of 45? Well, just to be easy, let's choose the bottom one. It's okay. Opposite side of this 45 angle would be here, adjacent would be here, and hypotenuse would be there. Sine of 45 is opposite over hypotenuse. So 1 over root 2. And I don't like the fact that it's a root on the denominator. We got to rationalize that. So I'm going to multiply top and bottom by 1. 1, quote unquote, which gives us root 2 over 2, and that's why Abby's like, it's root 2 over 2. Okay? Some calculators will actually give that to you, but there it is. Let's move on. How about cosine of 45? We've got adjacent, remember, so katoa, adjacent over hypotenuse. Adjacent has a side of 1. Hypotenuse has a side of root 2. Again, I don't like that there's a radical in the denominator, so I multiply by 1, quote unquote. And there it is. Lastly, I have tangent, which is opposite over adjacent. What is that? 1 over 1. If you can remember this triangle, you don't have to memorize all of these units. You can figure it out on the spot. And that's what my goal is. Don't memorize the numbers because there's way too many to memorize. Memorize a triangle because it's visual. 1, 1, root 2. Any questions for that so far? We're still using just SOHCAH TOA. But I'm introducing this interesting, unique triangle, which helps us you which ha helped us figure out angles of 45. Please note, if you so chose to turn this into, sides of 2 and 2, you still get the same answer. What is 2 squared plus 2 squared? Well, that's 4 plus 4, that's 8. C would be the square root of 8. And what is the square root of 8? 2 root 2. So the hypotenuse would be 2 root 2. So in the same way, sine 45, what would it be? It would be opposite over hypotenuse. Opposite over hypotenuse, which is the same as 1 over root 2, because I can reduce. So you still get the same answer no matter what. So you don't have to worry about that. If you forget what numbers they are, just plug whatever number you want, right? Oh, this is supposed to, you know what? I'm going to put in a 10. And if that side is a 10, the bottom side has to be equal, so that must be a 10 too. I'll do the Pythagorean theorem, and I'll figure out what the hypotenuse is. It's the same stuff. Okay? So, I've established 45 degrees. Let me try to delete all this. And we are now going to look at the 30 degrees. Is there a way for me to bring this up without having to erase? Oops. Okay. Some of you might still be copying or whatever, so I'm just going to keep that there. Everything else, I am going to delete. Okay, next. The next triangle is on your sheet as well. If you have a pencil with you, which you should, what I'd like you to do is actually extend this triangle and mirror it on the left side to create an equilateral triangle. And an equilateral triangle has angles 60, 60, and 60. The sides of the triangle, because they're equilateral, I also want you to put 2, 2, and 2. So the previous triangle was 1, 1. The other next triangle is 2, 2, 2. If I were to cut this triangle perfectly in half so that it is a right angle with a height right there, the base half of 2 would be 1. And half of 60 degrees would be 30 degrees. That's where we're going. So I'm going to erase all this, because now that we established hypotenuse is a 2, because that's part of the equilateral triangle, remember? And the base is a 1, because that's half of a 2. What is my height? I'm going to use Pythagorean theorem again. Hypotenuse squared is equal to the base squared plus the, let's call it h for height, the height squared. 4 equals 1 plus height squared. Subtract both sides by 1. 3 equals height squared. That means height is equal to a square root of 3, and that is why we have square root of 3 on the other side of the triangle. So let's do it. What is sine of 30? And what is cosine of 30? And what is tangent of 30. Once we establish that, what is sine of 60? What is cosine of 60? And what is tangent of 60? Can you work that out? Everyone, just take a minute to match correctly. If you're dealing with 30, that's your opposite and that's your adjacent. 1 is your opposite, root 3 is your adjacent. If you're dealing with 60, root 3 is your opposite and the 1 is your adjacent. Please figure out the 6 right now. No calculator, no decimals needed. I am going to call on, let's see, can I call on, Abby already gave me something. Aiden, can I call you for the 30 degrees, all three? And Alex, can I call you for the 60s, all three? Without using a calculator. Just take a minute. I was in the washroom. I don't know what's going on. Okay. I will take care of it. Alex, you keep working on it. So sine. We know that sine involves opposite over hypotenuse. So let's see, I'm gonna erase this. 30 degrees. 30 degrees is right here. And so opposite is 1, hypotenuse is 2. Ta-da! It's not 0.5, 1 over 2, please. Cosine is adjacent over hypotenuse, so that would be root 3 over 2. And tangent, opposite over adjacent, 1 over root 3. And I don't like the fact that there's a radical underneath, so I'm going to multiply by a 1, leaving me root 3 over 3. There you go. What's next? Sine of 60. Alex, you got it? Still working on it? That's okay. What do you have so far? You have sine 60? It'll just help confirm whether you're on the right track, too. Okay. Let's see. Let's see if you confirmed it. Sine 60 means I'm dealing with the 60 degrees. Sine means opposite over hypotenuse. So opposite in this case is root 3, hypotenuse is 2. You can check your answers with that. Again, cosine means I am, so cosine means ka. I'm dealing with adjacent over hypotenuse. So the answer is 1 over 2. And tangent, opposite over adjacent is root 3 over 1, and I don't have to do anything with that, it's just root 3. So there are your special triangles. So some of you are thinking, Mr. Kim, do you really have to memorize this? Unfortunately, I'm going to say yes, you do have to memorize it. Would there be one for 90 degrees? Yes, there is. But hold that. I'm glad you asked. When you're dealing with things like 0 degrees and 90 degrees, you can plug it into the calculator and it gives you some funky answers. It sort of makes sense if you apply to triangles, but it makes even more sense when we apply it to circles. So if you really are curious, and I hope you are, Alex, and everyone else, hold the idea and the question of what happens if it's 0 degrees and 90 degrees and how do we explain that. We are going to apply this understanding of opposite and adjacent and all that stuff onto a Cartesian coordinate and then explore what happens when we have an angle of 0 and an angle of 90. Okay, next part. If you want to use a little bit of the blank space on the special triangles handout, I'm going to show you a different way that I used when I was in high school. It's something that my teacher taught me, saying if you don't like the special triangles, if you don't like to memorize it, use this. And I liked it because it was more of a pattern. These special triangles are much more visual, so if you like just memorizing by looking at shapes, use it. Okay. Wait, we have to memorize how to find the answers, not the actual answers themselves, right? Both. If you know how to find the answers, then you should be able to get the right answers too. You get me? Sort of. If you memorize the special triangles, you should be able to find sine, cosine, and tangent of 30, sine, cosine, tangent of 60, and sine, cosine, tangent of 45. But I didn't like that. And so my teacher gave me this, and I will pass this on to you to see if you like it. Would you please copy this chart? I'll give you a minute. And once you're good, just give me a thumbs up or something. I want everyone to at least be on a similar page so that I don't rush it. A sine, cosine, and then 0, 30, 45, 60, and 90. Okay, we got a couple of people, good. Okay, more and more people. All right. This is the last couple people. Right. I'm gonna try to go at a decent speed so I don't bore you. Here we go. Everything that I'm saying is going to be in a clockwise rotation. Starting from zero, I'd like you to fill in the four corners with zero, one, a big fat zero, and a one. Can you do that for me? This means that sine of zero is equal to one, and a cosine of zero equals, sorry, a sine of zero equals zero, and a cosine of zero equals one. A sine of 90 equals one, and a sine, sorry, a cosine of 90 equals a zero. They're completely opposite of each other, and you'll understand in the next couple of lessons. Probably after the test, you'll get to see it. Ah, very good question. I love you guys. The reason why I am not putting a tan is, again, it's gonna reveal itself after we get to the circle idea. But for now, tangent is basically whatever you have for sine divided by whatever you get for cosine. So if I say tangent of 0 degrees, that's the same as sine of 0 degrees over cosine of 0 degrees. You'll see why this relationship is true later on when we get to like the end of chapter four. You may have to just memorize it, but tangent is literally sine divided by cosine. I'll give you a better example once we get through this chart, and you'll understand. Just let me finish this chart, and I will explain why tangent is equal to sine over cosine. Okay? Right. 0101. I hope everyone's ready. Next, in small numbers, I like you to count to three. One, two, three, one, two, three. In small numbers, write one, two, three, and then clockwise, one, two, three. Next, I would like you to divide the three small numbers you wrote. It's actually a fraction. Divide every single one of those numbers by two. So slash two, slash two, slash two, slash two, slash two, slash two, in the same clockwise direction. Good. And lastly, every single numerator, I'd like you to put a square root on it, then it matters. So if you do square root of one, it doesn't change the value, but just do it anyways. Square root of one, numerator, square root, square root, square root, square root, square root. And you're done. Take a look at the values that you have in the chart with what we have with the special triangles. Okay. I'm going to use color to try to highlight everything for you. You ready? Here we go. We've got all right. So sine of 30 is half. Sine of 30, half. Let's see. Sine of, where's sine of 45? Where do we get sine of 45? Sine of 45, root 2 over 2, sine of 45, root 2 over 2. And then sine of 30, root 3 over 2, sine of 30, sorry, sine of 60, root 3 over 2, sine of 60, root 3 over 2. Using blue, cosine of 30 is root 3 over 2, cosine of 30, root 3 of 2. Cosine of 45, root 2 over 2, cosine of 35, 45, root 2 over 2, and cosine of 60, half, cosine of 60, half. Okay, so if you don't like the special triangles, maybe you like patterns. You ready? four corners go 0, 1, 0, 1. The remaining parts that are blanks, I want you to do 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. Then, slash, 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 2, 2, 2, 2, 2, 2, and then root, 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 root. I don't know if that helps. For me, it did. I preferred that kind of pattern. It was easier for me to memorize a pattern than to memorize shapes. It was just how my brain worked. Either way is okay. But you're gonna have to do it one way or the other and make sure you have these values under your belt. Any questions? Questions before I get to tangent. No? Okay, then I am going to get to tangent and try to explain why tangent is going to equal the same as sine over cosine. Tan 45. Oh, geez, that was not what I wanted to do. That was trippy. Okay. Tan 30, tan 45, tan 60. All right, here we go. If you remember, sine was supposed to be opposite over hypotenuse, and cosine is adjacent over hypotenuse. On a whim, if you decide to divide sine with cosine, that is on the same triangle, doing opposite over hypotenuse divided by adjacent over hypotenuse. And what do you know about dividing fractions? It's better to multiply by the reciprocal. And if I reduce and that turns into 1, you get opposite over adjacent. Huh. When have you ever seen opposite over adjacent? Koa. So you can say tangent is the same as sine over cosine. So let's try it. Tangent, so I'll use blue, I'll continue using blue. Tangent of 45, let's do 30. Tangent of 30 degrees is like saying sine of 30 degrees, root, or so 1 over 2, divided by cosine of 30 degrees, which is root 3 over 2. And what do you know about dividing fractions? It's the same as multiplying the reciprocal. Shoop, shoop. And you get 1 over root 3. I don't like a radical in the denominator, so I'm going to multiply it by root 3 over root 3. And ta-da! Tangent of 30 degrees is the same as a special triangle that we used before. I'll use a different color. Oops. Tangent of 45 degrees is sine of 45, which is root 2 over 2, divided by cosine of 45, which is root 2 over 2. And I could do the multiplication of the reciprocal, but I notice that this value and this value are exactly equal to each other. So what is any number divided by itself? It's 1. So that and that are equal. And I think you'll believe me when you say tan 60, if I divide this value, sine of 60, with this value, cosine of 60, you will get root 3 over 1. Oof. It seems like a lot, but all of this is just an explanation of one of two different strategies. You're going to have to either memorize the special triangles so that you can figure out 30, 45, and 60 immediately, or memorize this chart, this 2 by 5 chart, and just remember how to divide fractions to find tangent. If you're like, no, Mr. Kim, dividing fractions, that's not, I'm not about that life, okay? Then you gotta go for the triangles. You have to. And you just gotta match it. Memorize those triangles. If you don't mind dividing fractions because you know how to flip and multiply the reciprocal, then this chart might be a lot more methodical and easier for you. Any questions? Sorry about that. It's my baby. Okay. No other questions? Again, I hope it's not overwhelming. We spent a good chunk of time just trying to explain the special triangles. I am going to move on to add one more thing. This is from chapter 4.3, so this is where you might want a another piece of paper. Okay? And just to let you know, I'm not sure if I'll be able to cover all of that bottom. I did try to cover it with my previous class this morning, and because of the test, they were just like checked out. So most likely I'm gonna revisit this. Let's keep it simple. We'll do 4.3, and I just want to talk a little bit about this portion to get us ready for applying this to circles. Okay. Take out your piece of paper. I am going to get us to learn something called reciprocal ratios. So please write that on the top and underline it. Let me get us started. Up until now, you have learned primary ratios, and that is sine theta, cosine theta, and tangent theta. I am now going to introduce reciprocal ratios because, occasionally, there are cases where it's not sine that we're dealing with. We're actually dealing with like a fraction, 1 over sine. Sometimes we have to divide 1 by sine or 1 by cosine, 1 by tangent. It's just a relationship, just like how we were saying up until now we've been dealing with x. What if we have to deal with 1 over x? It's that same idea. And when we do so, we, instead of calling it 1 over sine, we've given it newer names. Again, there's reason behind that. Like, there's a reason why we call it a secant or whatnot. But anyways, the three words I want to introduce are secant. Okay, so that's secant. And just like how there's sine and a corresponding sine or cosine, if there's a secant, there is a corresponding secant. Okay, so co secant. And the last one for tangent is cotangent. I'll say it right now. The reason why I wrote co first, like you wrote sine here and then cosine is next. The reason I write co first and then secant next is because cosecant matches up with sine. Cosecant is 1 over sine. Secant is 1 over cosine. And cotangent is, well, it's the last one, so 1 over tangent. This is reciprocal ratios. So I'm gonna just stay tuned. I'm gonna put this and put the special triangles together very soon as an exercise practice. If sine is, remember, opposite over hypotenuse, then cosecant is 1 over sine, which is like 1 over opposite over hypotenuse. And I'm not going to do that. If you know after all this practice, you know how to divide fractions, you multiply the reciprocal. Cosecant is hypotenuse over the opposite. It's complete reciprocal of sine. I'm going to follow suit without trying to show work. It's going to go really fast. Cosine is adjacent over hypotenuse. Secant is the reciprocal. And lastly, tangent is opposite over adjacent. Cotangent is adjacent over opposite. Now, do you really have to memorize, all of these? Oh, this is Josh. This is a new sheet. I just asked you to pull out a blank piece of paper and copy this down. It's just straight from the textbook, so I didn't feel like I needed to give a separate handout. You just need to see what they mean, and then, yeah. So let me just reiterate. Don't feel like you have to memorize hypotenuse over opposite, hypotenuse over adjacent, adjacent over opposite. If you know SOHCAHTOA already, all you have to do is connect sine with a cosecant, connect co with just the secant, and then tangent with the cotangent, and I just have to flip it. Okay? Don't feel like you have to memorize it. This is not about memorizing, it's just matching. Sine is with cosecant, and cosine is with secant. I know some people are still going to make a mistake by matching the wrong one. Okay, Zayana, go up, please. I'll pass you some work. If you want Kokoma, can you go up quietly? Or do you want to stay? Do you want to eat or do you want to stay? Gonna stay? Stay? Okay, turn it off. That parent life. Okay. Sine is with co secant. Cosine is with just secant. Very important, please don't mix it up. And then tangent is with cotangent, it's fine. All right. So here's a couple of little questions that I can ask that mix up everything. What is that? And if I ask, what is that? If I say, what is that? I'm going to give you a minute after we do the first one together. I like you to try secant of 30 and cotangent of 60. So try to recognize a pattern that I'm doing here. There's two ways I can go about it, but honestly, if you get one way and just or just general operations of math, you can do this. Cosecant, as you know, is equal to 1 over sine 45. And what is sine 45? Someone want to bust out their special triangle knowledge?
Root 2/2.
Root 2 over 2. So that is 1 divided by root 2 over 2. What do you know about dividing fractions? You are going to multiply by the reciprocal, leaving 2 root 2. Oh, shoot! The denominator is a radical. So you can multiply both top and bottom by root 2. And then guess what happens? So multiply top and bottom root 2. This is 2 root 2 over 2. And you can simplify, it becomes just root 2, which makes sense. If you gave me the answer for using special triangles, you'd have said this was 1 over root 2, right? So instead of 1 times 2 over root 2, this would actually be just 1 times root 2 over 1. But either way, you get the same answer. Okay? Another way you can do it is just figure out what this is and then flip it. Right? Remember, I told you if cosecant is sorry, if sine is opposite over hypotenuse, cosecant is just the reciprocal of that. So sine 45, you know it's 1 over root 2. That means cosecant must be root what 2 over 1. It's as simple as that. You can do it either way and you get the same answer. I'll give you, I'm going to say literally, about 30 seconds each. Can you give an honest attempt with secant 30 and cotangent of 60? Give it a shot. I'm literally going to turn on a countdown. One minute. Here we go. Okay, what do we got for secant of 30? Anyone?
Two root 3/3.
2 root 3 over 3? Let me. Anyone else? I actually just gave these numbers because I thought it was going to be a good exercise. So let's try it. Let's try it. Secant of 30 is essentially secant is related to cosine. So cosine of 30, I'm going to just use my chart 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. It's root 3 over 2. And so secant must be the reverse of that, 2 over root 3. But again, you can't do radicals, so you are correct. It's 2 root 3 over 3. Final answer. Let's try it again. Cotangent of 60. Someone feel a little bit more confident in their answer after seeing this? Cotangent of 60. Someone else? Going once, going twice. Okay, well, I don't know the answer myself. I gotta do it. So cotangent is related to tangent of 60, which is related to sine 60 over cosine of 60. You know what? I don't want to deal with divisions right now because I'm quite tired. So let's look at the special triangle. Tan of 60 is opposite over adjacent. It is root 3 over 1. Well, if that's the case, cotangent of 60 must be 1 over root 3, which I don't like. I'm going to multiply top and bottom by root 3, giving us root 3 over 3. done, and done. So this is reciprocal ratios. How was that? Any questions?
Sorry, can you explain what you did for the last one again?
Sure. So cotangent, I know that it's related to tangent. So I took a look at the special triangles, and I saw that if the angle is a 60, my opposite side is a root 3, my adjacent side is a 1. So tangent of 60 is opposite over adjacent, which is root 3 over 1, right there. Cotangent is the reciprocal of tangent. Another way I could write it is cotangent is 1 over tan 60, which is 1 over root 3 over 1, which is the same as 1 divided by root 3 over 1. And that's the same as, let me erase this, 1 divided by root 3 over 1 is like, well, it's just, yeah, 1 divided by root 3 over 1 is basically saying 1 divided by root 3, right? From there, I don't like the fact that there is a radical in the denominator, so I multiply that by a value of quote-unquote 1, giving us the answer root 3 over 3. That's it. Any other questions? Let's clarify some things. Okay, so just to recap, we talked about special triangles, which lets us, quote-unquote, memorize special angles of 30, 45, and 60. We haven't talked about 0 degrees or 90 degrees, but if you look, use my chart instead, you already know it either equals 0 or 1, depending on what angle I'm using and what ratio I'm using. From that chart, we also learned that tangent is equal to sine or cosine. Sine over cosine. And using our special triangles of 30, 45, and 60 degrees, we can even apply that to this thing called reciprocal ratios. We're learning the three new ratios are cosecant, secant, and cotangent. That's basically a summary of today. How are we? Any questions? Okay, well, again, if you do want to return to this, the recording will be up. I want to do two things. Let me fix our homework on page 4.1 on the handout. Could you please do not do these questions until we've covered chapter 4.2, okay? So from page 228, so that's chapter 4.1. Numbers 2, 5, and 10, I'd like you to do later. I think it's too much for you to do right now, given the information, and we haven't covered everything that I want to cover. From page 246, that's 4.3, I would like you to do number 5 later. That will be a very confusing question to you without doing something called the CAST rule. Okay, and that I'm going to say for 4.2, especially because you have a test coming up. Okay, please record that. And once you do so, I want to just tackle the top part of, sorry, I want to go to our 4.1 handout, cover a couple of, I guess, technical things that you will need to know as we go into chapter 4.2 tomorrow. And then I want to sort of propose another system of looking at angles so that you'll be sort of more receptive to chapter 4.2. Okay, so I'm going to assume that you've had this copied down somewhere or you made a little note of it. I'm going to go ahead and share our handout. Okay. I know I have about 10 minutes left. I'm going to be very quick. I'm gonna throw an idea at you, for and I don't want you to memorize it or learn it. I just want you to be like, huh, that's interesting. I see where that might be going. I don't quite understand it, but I'll wait for us to have another discussion. Because this thing that I'm starting right now, we're gonna have it for 2 more days after today. That includes after the test. Here it is. Take a look. Up until now, in grade 10, you've always been given 3 sides of a triangle, and you're dealt with, you know, one side here, 2 side here, and then the hypotenuse 3 side there, right? Well, this base, we are going to assume is always going to be lined up with the x-axis on a Cartesian coordinate, and if we pretend the hypotenuse is rising from the floor in this counterclockwise direction, and there's my theta, I can create an imaginary triangle with the radius of my circle being the hypotenuse. And this portion of my imaginary triangle could be considered my adjacent side. And of course, the dotted line, I can consider it to be my opposite side. I'll do it one more time. Okay, I'll draw it one more time. If we assume that the base of my triangle is lined up with the x-axis, my hypotenuse of my triangle is this arrow right here. And then the angle that is created by those two arms is my theta. Just like how there's a dotted line on this lower triangle that I drew, I can create an imaginary triangle on a circle on a Cartesian coordinate and use the same SOHCAHTOA stuff that we've been practicing on a triangle, but we are applying it to a Cartesian. So based on this theta, this would be my adjacent side, which is technically my x. This is going to be my opposite side, which you can say is my y. And the hypotenuse is essentially the same as the radius of the circle that we're dealing with. Okay. And why am I going through all this? I need to introduce a quick terminology. The starting arm, the arm that's always on the x-axis, is going to be what we call the initial arm, the start arm. The hypotenuse portion, the arm that we end our angle, the angle is squeezed inside, is what we're going to call the terminal arm or terminating arm, the ending arm, the final arm. Okay, so initial arm and terminal arm. And these two arms are going to be what's dictating the base and hypotenuse of our imaginary triangle. Okay. Any questions about that new system? Seriously, like, this is fresh and this is new. If you're confused, you can ask. I'm going to go to the next page and show you why I'm introducing adjacent and opposite with x and y and stuff. And then from there, maybe you can ask some more questions. I'm going to clear this for a sec. Okay. Get your questions ready. If this is confusing or whatnot, just be ready to ask a question. Okay. I have with me a hypothetical circle with radius of 5. So here, my point would be 0, 5. That point right there is 5, 0, which means the radius of this circle is a 5. That means this terminal arm is going to have a length of 5 as well. Okay, so let me redraw that. That's going to be a 5 as well. Knowing my Pythagorean theorem, I know, I'm going to say that this arrow is touching the point 3, 4. Now, I might be running out of space. I'm going to write 3, 4. All right, people. My x value is a 3. My y value is a 4. My imaginary triangle is fitted inside this perfect circle centered at the origin. What is the base of this triangle?
Three.
Yeah. Do you see it? If my point is 3, 4, that means I must have moved 3 points to the right, and my height must be
4.
Thank you. Whew. Someone. Okay. This is what I mean by applying our trigonometry, our opposite, adjacent, and hypotenuse into a circle. If I say literally, here's my point, the terminal arm hits 3, 4, that automatically tells me that the base of my imaginary triangle is a 3, and my height is going to be a 4. And remember, the 4 also corresponds with the opposite side, and my base corresponds with the adjacent side, and my radius is my hypotenuse. Right? But instead of opposite, because we're on a Cartesian coordinate, opposite is now the y value, adjacent is now the x value, and hypotenuse can be written as my radius. In other words, starting from next lesson, instead of using the terms opposite, adjacent, and hypotenuse, I can interchange them with x value, y value, and r value. So if you want to write this, the y value would be my opposite, my x value is my adjacent, and my radius would be my hypotenuse. That's going to be interchangeable if we have it on a Cartesian coordinate. I'm slowly trying to introduce to you that opposite and adjacent, if we tether, if we connect the triangle onto the origin, the point 3, 4 can reveal so much about the triangle, and we can use basic trigonometry to solve more about circles as well. It opens up a whole new world of not just triangles, but dealing with circular situations, circular shapes.
Are we going to go over this again?
We haven't even started. So next lesson and the lesson afterwards is the official lesson for this.
Okay, thank you.
I just wanted to show you that x and y and adjacent, opposite, and hypotenuse are going to be sort of interchangeably be used with x, y, and r when we deal with circles. Like, I just want you to be flexible and be open to it so that when we learn it, like, for real next class, it'll be like, okay, I've seen this before. Let's try to absorb it a bit better. Okay? And again, you can always look at the video afterwards if you want, but you have to focus on the test. Let's finish this. What is the adjacent length? So if this is my theta, my adjacent length is right here. What is the adjacent length with reference to theta? It is 3, because the adjacent length is basically saying, what is my x? Okay, what is my x length? If it asks for what is the opposite of theta, it's like saying, what is the y value of theta? And that would be a 4. And this is spelled wrong, but if the question is asking what is the hypotenuse length, that's the same thing as saying what is the radius of the circle, and that would be a 5. Okay? We're going to stop right there. Don't want it to be overloaded. Some of you are still copying. I'm going to do a quick rundown of what I think is most important. 4.1. Be able to write out your special triangles. Just quickly draw it out, literally. Do a quick quiz on yourself. Look at the special triangles, close the book, and see if you can write the two triangles. It's like a pop quiz for yourself. And keep on doing it until you've memorized it. You can do it like instantly. All right? Special triangles. You need to know your 30, 45, and 60. Next, 4.3, we looked at reciprocal ratios. And see if you can answer or do exercises with reciprocal ratios using the special angles, because they're going to be related to each other. Okay? If you can do the homework for that, please don't do the questions I specified earlier. Do the other ones that I have written in the handout. And then next time we meet, we're going to go more into this idea of fitting a triangle in a circle and using X, Y, and R instead of adjacent, opposite, hypotenuse. And then I'm going to show you a shortcut that lets you, if you can figure out this quarter, then you have figured out all three. Like there, because it's a circle and they're all symmetrical, if you could do one quarter of the circle, you essentially figured out the rest of the circle. It's a incredible relationship that you sort of discover as you learn more about it, and I'm excited to teach that to you. Any questions? What size should the reference sheet for the test be? Your study sheet is going to be 8.5 by 11. I gave permission to use both sides because it's not a big deal whether you use both sides or not. There are some students that I saw today writing a test. They had a cue card, and that's all they needed. Other people filled the entire sheet by copying example questions we did in class, which tells me that they didn't really study the way they should. Just because you copy a question doesn't mean that you can just reproduce exactly into a test question. Anyways, are we going to have an exam? I can't answer that question. I don't know. But if the first two quads are any indication, I don't think so. One thing I do want to say, I had a bit of a pep talk with the first class who wrote a test today. All of them, majority of the class felt that the test was challenging but fair, and they, most of them were sort of regretful that they didn't give themselves enough time to study, because after they saw the test, they're like, this is a very doable test. But maybe because this was the first test, they were very overwhelmed and they were scared. So that kept them from being more motivated than they should be. Okay? The only thing I can say to you that you could benefit from the previous class is, it's a doable test. It's a very doable test. The questions, there were no surprises from anything outside of what I told the class that you can expect. And a lot of them were like, if I knew this was going to be the test, I would have studied better and I would have done so much better. So what you're fighting with right now is yourself and the fear of an unknown. So study really hard, knowing that it's very doable. Will we get the mark on Google Classroom? Yes. Once I mark everything, I'm going to create an empty slot that says Chapter 1 to 3 test. I'm going to manually put everything there so your mark gets updated, and what's in our Google Classroom is your exact mark. Okay, so don't be regretful. Study hard. You can do this. It's not easy, but it's not like impossible. It's not that level. It's a fair, you know, I did my best to try to wage it so that it's challenging but fair, right? There's no surprises, right? If you got to simplify, simplify. If you have to reduce, reduce. If you have to write it right, you want to have the radical in the denominator, make sure it's not there, so on and so forth. Cover your butt. This is very doable. Any other questions? If you don't have any questions, we've already passed 3:15. You are formally dismissed. I will see you tomorrow at 2:00. I'll stay, stick around. Yep, no problem. I'll stick around a little bit for any questions you might have before I close this meeting.
Thank you, Mr.
Thank you.
Yep, no problem.